Hey everyone, welcome to Integrated Medical Biochemistry with Dr. Bijoya. Now this time we will be discussing the part 2 of nephrotic syndrome as a case study. The case is about an 8-year-old girl who attended a pediatrician's OPD. She had fever since last 4 to 5 days and had generalized pitting edema for 10 days. The mother complained that the edema started from face, eyes, and then it extended to the limbs. The general examination was the body weight of the girl was 11 kgs, facial puffiness was observed, preorbital edema was positive, bilateral pitting edema was seen, body temperature was 100 degree Fahrenheit, pulse was 90 per minute, heart sounds were regular without murmurs, respiratory rate was 20 per minute, and blood pressure was 110/75. The systemic examination included abdominal examination and respiratory examination. The abdominal examination of the girl showed mild abdominal wall edema, which was not tender. It was distended and showed symptoms of mild ascites. The respiratory examination showed tachycardia, coughing, shallow breathing, bilateral crepitations, bilateral bronchi. The X-ray finding of the patient showed bacterial pneumonia. This is a comparison between normal X-ray and that of the patient. The USG findings of the patient showed mild ascites. This is again a comparison between normal USG and a USG of the patient, where you can see that there is accumulation of water in the abdominal cavity, which is known as ascites. The laboratory reports of the patient showed urine investigations and blood investigations. In urine investigations, urinary protein was 5 grams per day, which was very high. However, urine, RBC, pus cells and casts were absent. In blood investigations, the plasma, total proteins and albumin were below their normal range. Fasting blood glucose was normal and plasma cholesterol was elevated. Based on these lab reports, the provisional diagnosis of the doctor was nephrotic syndrome. The goals of the medication in nephrotic syndrome are generally to remove the fluid overload, reduction and disappearance of proteinuria, and preventions of complication and due to infection and thrombosis. Now, with these goals in mind, the pediatrician admitted the patient in pediatric ward and the treatment was started. The treatment plan showed an injection of ceftriaxone, an antibiotic, methylprednisolone, a steroid to suppress the immunity and to work against the proteinuria. A paracetamol injection was given, SOS for fever, pantoprazole for heartburns, syrup TuskQD for cough, and nebulization with Duolin and Budercort were also started. A daily chart was to be maintained by the nurse for urine input, output, body temperature and weight. The nephrotic syndrome is actually a collection of symptoms that indicate kidney damage, particularly damage to the glomeruli. Congenital disease and childhood nephrotic syndrome is rare and it affects infants in the first 3 months of life. This is also known as infantile nephrotic syndrome. Nephrotic syndrome is primarily a pediatric disorder and most common chronic renal disease of the childhood. Now let us see what are the changes in glomerulus that occurs in nephrotic syndrome. This is the normal glomerulus, where you can see that the glomerular basement membrane has glomerular epithelial cells with foot processes. They are known as the podocytes. These podocytes have negative charges. The albumin in blood also has negative charges, and both of them repel each other, and therefore albumin remains in the circulation and unable to cross the glomerular membrane. The RBCs are big in size and therefore they are also unable to cross the glomerular basal membrane. Now, however, in nephrotic syndrome, there is leaky glomerular basement membrane, which lead this is due, happens due to injured or disrupted endothelial cell membrane. So there is detachment and loss of podocytes and foot processes. The podocytes lose their negative charge, which makes the basement membrane leaky, and the albumin can easily cross through these and reach the urine. So sometimes even RBCs leak out, and therefore there is proteinuria and hematuria seen in nephrotic syndrome. Now the primary causes of nephrotic syndrome include minimal change nephrotic syndrome, which occurs in 70 to 90% of the children, the focal segmental glomerulosclerosis, which is seen in 10 to 20% of the children, and membranoproliferative glomerulonephritis, which is seen in 5 to 15% of the children. So majority of the children suffer from minimal change nephropathy syndrome, which is abbreviated as MCNS. The secondary causes of nephrotic syndrome include various other diseases which may injure the glomerular integrity. These include diabetes mellitus, systemic lupus erythematosus, hepatitis B, C, NSAIDs, amyloidosis, multiple myeloma, and HIV. The nephrotic syndrome patient presents himself with the classic tetrad. This is a mnemonic for the classic tetrad is HELP. Now, H stands for hypoalbuminemia and hypercoagulability due to loss of proteins in urine, and sometimes there may be loss of coagulation factors also. E stands for edema, L stands for dyslipidemia, and P stands for proteinuria. So, this makes a nice acronym to remember, that is HELP. The mechanism of edema shows that there is massive proteinuria, which leads to hypoalbuminemia, because albumin is a chief protein which is lost in the glomerulus. Due to this, there is decreased plasma oncotic pressure, which leads to movement of intravascular fluid into the interstitial space. There is decrease in circulating volume of blood because of the movement of intravascular fluid into interstitial space, and this leads to activation of renin-angiotensin system, which increases the antidiuretic hormone and aldosterone, which retain sodium and water in the tubules by reabsorption, which further aggravates edema. So this is the mechanism of edema in nephrotic syndrome. Now this is the child. Pictures of a child having edema. Let us see the face. The face is puffy. Eyes are swollen due to periorbital edema. This is after resolving. So resolving of edema after the treatment. So you can see the difference. The hands also show edema and the feet show pitting edema. So this is how the person would look like if he has edema. The complications of nephrotic syndrome include pleural effusion and ascites. Pleural effusion is built up of fluid around the lungs, and ascites is built up of fluid inside the abdominal cavity. The symptoms of pleural effusion include dry cough, shortness of breath, chest pain, difficulty in breathing properly, whereas the symptoms of ascites include abdominal pain, swollen abdomen, weight gain, loss of appetite, and shortness of breath due to fluid filled in the abdominal cavity. Now, nephrotic syndrome also induces hyperlipidemia. So, actually what happens is that there is massive proteinuria, because of which the LDL receptors, being proteins, are not expressed sufficiently. So, LDL circulation remains high in blood. There is due to reduced uptake of LDL, so serum LDL levels are high, which increases the serum LDL cholesterol. Now the second change that occurs is that the hepatic enzymes ACAT and is activated, which and 7-alpha hydroxylase is inhibited. So the intracellular cholesterol HMG-CoA activation takes place, and there is increased production of cholesterol, which is packaged into the LDL by the liver and transported into the circulation, so there is increased serum LDL cholesterol. Now, due to dyslipidemia, sometimes there is xanthelasma and xanthomatosine. Xanthelasma is the deposition of lipids around the eye, and xanthomata is seen in the hands. The other complication of nephrotic syndrome is repeated infection in patients with it. So this is due to massive proteinuria. Immunoglobulins being proteins are also excreted out in urine. This reduces the patient's immunity, and there are pneumococcal infections, which are most common invasive bacterial infection in these children. Besides, there is pleural effusion, which can increase difficulty in breathing. So now, this is the these are the various diagnostic tests that can be performed with the patient presenting himself with the tetrad of hypoalbuminemia, hypercoagulability, edema, dyslipidemia, and proteinuria. So for this, such a patient, both urine and blood samples are collected. In urine sample, various biochemical tests can be done, such as urine protein, urine albumin, creatinine, and microscopy of urine. With blood, full blood count, LFT, RFT, serum electrolytes, and lipid profile are done. CRP and glucose may also be estimated to check inflammatory level and possibility of diabetic nephropathy. The antibody testing is also done by measuring serum and urine immunoglobulins. Autoimmune disorders may be screened. The patient may also be screened for hepatitis B, C, and HIV. Now let us come to the X-ray. The chest X-ray is taken to find out if there is any pleural effusion or there is pneumonia. The renal biopsy may be done in certain cases. So with the sample, light microscopy is done to see general changes. Immunofluorescence is done to see antibody or immune complex formation if there is any autoimmune cause for nephrotic syndrome. And the last and most accurate one is electron microscopy, which is done to see the detailed changes in glomerular membrane. This renal biopsy is done with the needle through which is USG guided. Now, after all this information given to you, now let us see what happens to the patient after 5 days of admission in the pediatric ward. There is post-treatment investigations. There is some improvement in all the investigations, although the problem is not completely resolved. However, the patient has responded to the treatment. So the pediatrician decides to discharge the patient. Before that, he gives parent counseling. The parent is first informed that nephrotic syndrome is a chronic disease, and the parent should be prepared for relapses. The parent is also trained to monitor first morning urine sample by dipstick method. Urine protein has to be monitored daily to check relapse, and body weight to be monitored regularly to see fluid accumulation or edema. Now this is the urine stick or dipstick, which is also known as uresticks. These are small chemical pads which are impregnated with reagents that are sensitive to abnormal constituents in urine. For example, this is a urine sample of a nephrotic syndrome patient, and this is impregnated with two pads. One is for specific gravity and one is for protein. Now, this is after dipping the uresticks into the urine. It is removed out and it is allowed to wait for 2 minutes, and then the results are compared with the color index given on the on the heuristics bottled by the manufacturer. Now, each color corresponds to the dipstick protein reading, and it gives us an idea about whether the sample is negative, it has trace amounts of proteins, or there is increased gradation of proteins in the urine. So this is how the parents were taught how to use the heuristics at home, because this is a very easy and convenient method to check the protein urea at home. It doesn't need any supervision. Now, the treatment on discharge for the patient was antibiotic treatment was continued, but the drug was changed. Prednisolone was continued, one tablet per day. Pantocid was given as to prevent heartburn. Syrup TuskQD was given as a cough syrup. Syrup paracetamol on SOS. High protein diet was recommended. For high protein diet, Threptin biscuits were given two biscuits twice a day. Apart from that, curds, eggs and milk pulses were also given, a follow up after 10 days. The source of protein in Threptin biscuits is casein, which is biologically the best protein. So each protein contains 1.5 grams of protein and it can be easily digested. So sometimes pediatricians recommend Threptin protein as a source of Threptin biscuits as a source of protein. Now, these are the questions which you may be able to answer after watching both the videos, part 1 and part 2. So please like, share and subscribe to my channel and click on the bell icon. Thank you. Have a good day.